shed my blood for that one. That one. Oh, you're not redeemed with corruptible things. Let's see where Peter said that. I think it's in 1 Peter. He said, you're not redeemed with corruptible things, such as silver and gold. That's 1 Peter, the first chapter, and verse 18, where the apostle said that. For as much as you know, you were not redeemed with corruptible things. We don't understand redemption very much. You don't see much of it in modern society. Be a little bit with pawn shops. People pawn their goods, and for a period of time, they can go in and pay enough money to redeem and get their goods back. But in the world of the Bible, there was a thing such as slavery. People could be sold into slavery if they didn't have money to pay their debts or whatever their circumstances were, and if they became a slave, they lost all their rights. And under the Roman law, it was very difficult for a slave to ever become free. But under God's law, the law of God, there was a provision made where a near kinsman could pay enough money to redeem his brother out of bondage, out of slavery. It was very expensive. You had to really care a lot about your relative to sacrifice enough to bring the gold that was necessary to free your brother or your sister from the bondage of slavery. We don't have much slavery in the world today, thank God. We don't, but the concept is something we should understand, that every one of us were slaves to sin. Martin Luther said we were born slaves, and we were born in the house of bondage. We weren't in the house of bread, we were in the house of bondage, and we were slaves. Fortunately, though, there was a near kinsman, and his name was Jesus. And he said, I'm willing to pay the price to redeem my brothers and sisters from the bondage of sin and from the penalty of sin, the condemnation of sin, which is an everlasting separation from God and death and hell. But he said, I'll redeem them out of the hand of the enemy, and I'll redeem them out of death. I'll redeem them out of their graves. I'll redeem them out of hell. He said, I'm willing to pay the price. But what was it? It wasn't silver or gold. The scripture here we're reading says, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your vain conversation, from your life that you lived. But what were you redeemed with? Verse 19 says, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. And it's the blood of Jesus that washes us. That's what we were singing. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It will wash you white as snow. Brother George Mugai in Africa, they would be singing that in Swahili. They'd be saying, Tamu ya Yesu. Tamu ya Yesu. Tamu ya Yesu. Husufisha kapisa. It washes completely, white as snow. Husafisha kapisa. It washes completely, doesn't it, Brother George? It washes completely. Isaiah, the first chapter. There's a scripture in Isaiah chapter 1 I want to turn to for a moment about what the Lord can do for you. He said in the first chapter of Isaiah in verse 18, come now. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. When should you come? You should come right now. Come now to the Lord. Don't put it off. Don't wait another moment. Don't wait another day. You never know. Come now and let us reason together. Saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as white as a little lamb's wool. The Lord can wash your sins away. He will wash them as white as snow. So, what's the measure of true wealth? Let me ask that question. How wealthy are you? How do you measure your wealth? Is it done with a balance sheet? Is your wealth reflected in the amount of money that you have in the bank? Is it the value of the property that you own, your cars and your investments? What makes a man or a woman really, really wealthy? It's not silver and gold. Well, you can say wealth comes from being part of a loving family. Or you might say wealth comes from having peace in your heart. And I'll say, yes, that's true. But there's another wealth that you have, and it's the forgiveness that comes through the blood of Jesus, because it's worth more than all the treasures on earth combined. There's a scripture in Romans, the second chapter, that I want to focus on for just a moment here. When Paul was writing to a church there in Rome of redeemed men and women, and he was warning them not to despise something, not to despise certain wealth. And he said this in Romans, the second chapter, when he was telling them not to judge others and that God is the judge of all. But he said in verse 4, he said, "Do you despise the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance?" He's saying that true wealth is not silver. It's not gold or material goods. But there are certain attributes of God that have led us to repent of our sins and accept the blood of Jesus into our life to cleanse us. Those things are goodness. The goodness of God. I want to tell you, God is good. Paul had just said in a few earlier verses that God was going to judge sinners. And he was saying in the first chapter of Romans about how wicked people had become. They became reprobate in their minds, and God was going to judge them. And they're worthy of death, chapter 1 and verse 32 says. And those who do that kind of thing, chapter 2 and verse 3, are going to come under the judgment of God. But there is a goodness. And if you've received the goodness of God, that's the most valuable gift you can ever attain in your life. It's worth more than platinum. It's worth more than diamonds. It's worth more than investments. It's worth more than anything you can have. The goodness of God and his long-suffering, putting up with us, and his forbearance when he could have smitten us for our transgressions. He put up with a lot of things, his forbearance. Those are great treasures because they lead us to a point where we can be made right with God and ready to live forever in a warm embrace of God's love and fellowship. That's an awesome thing. I'm not going to turn back to Isaiah again, but there's a statement in Isaiah 59, and I think it's verse 2, where the prophets, the Lord said it through his prophet, "Your sins and your iniquities have separated you from your God." God cannot embrace that which is sinful and wrong. And the only way that we can ever have fellowship with God, we sing a song sometimes that says, "Friendship with Jesus, fellowship divine." But the only way you can fellowship the divine is to be washed white as snow. The only way you can have your sins washed as white as snow is through the precious blood of Jesus, the Lamb of God, who was slain from the foundation of the world. Goodness and forbearance and long-suffering of our Heavenly Father is seen in God, the majesty on high, taking the time and the effort that's needed to lead a needy soul to salvation. God's good. When we would be tempted to give up on somebody, God hasn't given up on you. When we would be tempted to turn our backs on miserable failures and walk away, God has never turned his back and walked away from you. But he keeps exercising goodness He keeps forbearing to judge because it leads you to repentance. That's a very powerful scripture in Romans 2:4. It's the goodness and the long-suffering and the forbearance of God that leads us to repentance, that gets us right with God. I think the churches will fail if they don't point out our need to repent and get right with God. If all we do is make people feel good about themselves, you know, God loves you just the way you are, don't change anything, then we're not doing what we're supposed to do. We need to deal with the sin that is separated between us and our God. We need to get it cleared out. You can sing, you can shout, you can hear good messages, you can praise God, you can listen to testimonies. But if you go out this door with the same sins you brought in, what has it profited you? What has it profited you? If you go out the door with the same weaknesses and problems and faults in your life that you brought in, what has it profited you? We need to be cleansed from the sin that doth so easily beset us. The work of God is to wash us as white as snow. We need a church that declares our need to, and not only our need, but the way to purge the vile wickedness of our hearts so that we can have a relationship with God that brings true joy and peace. If you don't walk in joy every day, then you're living beneath your privilege as a child of God. If your heart isn't content, if you don't have peace, then you're living beneath your privilege as a child of God. Because the goodness and the forbearance and the long-suffering of God have led you and will lead you to a place of repentance where you can have peace with God. Every one of us need the cleansing. I don't think there's anybody in this congregation who is exempt from the need to cleanse some wickedness. I'm not asking you to declare yourself. I don't believe in a confessional booth, but I think every one of us, if we'd look down on the inside, we'd see some bitterness in our heart. We'd see some anger. We'd see some resentment. We'd see some faults. We'd see some weaknesses that we have, whatever they may be, jealousy, whatever it is, evil concupiscence, lust, whatever it is. There's things down in our heart. There's thoughts that are in our mind that we really wouldn't want our thoughts projected on that screen for everybody here to see. You wouldn't want your thoughts for the last 24 hours projected up on that screen because you know what's in there. You know what's there, but God has a way. He provided a plan through the shed blood of Jesus Christ to begin a process that hasn't been completed yet, but it will cleanse us, and it can wash us. The washing of the water by the Word can cleanse our lives. In fact, there's a hymn, and I don't usually do this. We've had a good song service, and I really did appreciate the songs we sang. But I'm going to ask the congregation if you'll sing one more hymn with me. I'd like you to get your hymn books out and turn with me to page 216. There's a hymn in there that was written about 100 years ago. But there's truth in this. It's the title of it is Cleanse Me. And particularly the first three verses of this song, I think, are very appropriate to what we're talking about and going to be talking about today, if the Lord helps me. And so I would like to ask this congregation to join me. What we're going to do is sing verse 1, then verse 2, then verse 3, and then we're going to go back and sing verse 1 again. And think about the words as best you can as you sing this. Can I have an introduction, please? Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior. Know my thoughts, I pray. Praise God. Amen. 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 Now that's a song, that's a hymn, but we want to turn it into a prayer, the prayer of our hearts. Our church has proclaimed a message of overcoming sin from the very beginning. Yet, we know you can't overcome in your own strength. It takes the power of God through His Spirit and through His Word in order to rise above sin. But God's put a desire in us to do that. And if He put that desire in your heart, then He's going to give you the equipment, the tools that you need to overcome the weaknesses and the faults and to purify that that's within, as we were just singing in that song. God gave us these tools through the death of Jesus on the cross. We're approaching our annual communion service. This kind of a message would be good at any time, but particularly as we're looking toward the ceremony that commemorates the death of Jesus on a cross, the breaking of His body for us, and the shedding of His precious blood. And we should be examining our lives and repenting of the sinfulness that still resides in us. That's what Romans 2 and verse 4 says, do you despise His goodness? Let's not despise his goodness, nor his forbearance, nor his long-suffering. Many have through the years, and maybe you have in times past, but let's not do so today. Let's not despise the goodness of God. When Paul was writing about communion in 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, I just want to take one verse out of that, and that's the 28th verse. He said, "But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup." There should be an examination that's going on, and I'd like for us to spend the next couple of weeks examining our lives. You don't have to be perfect, but you should look into your own heart and examine yourself to see if you have any unrepented sins lurking in the dark recesses of your fallen soul. In order to really appreciate how much you need a Savior, you've got to understand how awful your sins are. And you got to be sorry and repent for those. You cannot appreciate that Jesus bore our sins in his body and purchased our redemption in his blood until you recognize how sick the human heart is, how dark it is in sins, how corrupting evil has been in your life. And so someone might say, well, the righteous, they don't need to repent. Or that you were converted years and years ago. And yes, I understand that. But there's still a nature in us that we have not fully dealt with that causes us to say things we shouldn't say, to get into attitudes that we shouldn't get into, to have thoughts that we dwell on that we ought not be harboring in our minds. John the Apostle in 1 John, the first chapter, was writing not to unsaved, but he was writing to people in the church, people like you and people like me. He was writing a letter to the saved. And in 1 John, the first chapter, starting in verse 8, he said, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we've not sinned, we've made him a liar and his word's not in us. But if we confess our sins," verse 9, "he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us." Cleanse me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior. That's what we were just singing, and that's what we need in our lives. In Acts, the second chapter, Peter was preaching the first inaugural message of the church. Our church started, when did our church start? In 1939? No, our church started on the day of Pentecost, 2,000 years ago. And our first preacher was a man by the name of Peter who stood up with the other 11 apostles and began to preach the Pentecostal message that day. He was not talking to a bunch of sinners. He wasn't talking to drunks in the gutter, thieves and adulterers and con artists. He was preaching to religious people who had come to a religious city as part of their religious duty to keep a religious feast. They were there because they loved God. They were there because they were serving God, because God's law had asked them to appear before the Lord in Jerusalem. That's why they were there. But Peter preached a message so hard against sin that they began they cried out to Peter, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" That's the end of verse 37. And when Peter looked at this crowd of people who'd come to worship the Lord, he said a very strong statement in verse 38, Acts 2 and verse 38. "Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. We use that scripture in altar calls for the sinners who've never met the Lord in repentance, and we tell them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus. And it's good to do that. But Peter wasn't talking to vile sinners. He was preaching to the devout. And he said, repent. And sometimes the devout need to hear a message of repentance just as much as the unsaved do. Paul used the term, the old man, to describe the wicked, fallen, sinful nature that's in us. And when we first find the Lord in salvation, a new nature is created when we receive the Holy Spirit of God. He's calling that a new man at times. But the old man is still there. Even though you've been saved, even though you're walking in life and light, and even though you have an assurance of salvation, there's still some old man in there. I don't really care for the term, but that's the term that Paul used, and so I'm going to stick with it. The old man. I'd rather say the old nature, but it's the old man that's in there. And sometimes somebody will do something, and there's an anger starts to rise up in me. Now, that's not Christ in me. That's not my new nature. That's the old man who's still alive. And that old man starts getting stirred with anger. And if I'm not careful, that anger will get away from me. And I'll get red in the face. And if I'm not careful, then I'll loosen my lips and my tongue will start wagging. And I'll say things that later I'll say, I wish I wouldn't have said that. But I said that in the heat of my anger because there's still an old man. That's what Paul called it. Let's look at three scriptures where Paul used that term. The first one's in Romans, the 6th chapter. It's in Romans and then Ephesians and then Colossians. But in Romans, the 6th chapter, Paul must have liked this term because he used it several times. But in Romans 6 and verse 6, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. Isn't that great? Our old man was crucified when Jesus was crucified. We don't serve sin anymore. The trouble is, I found out that my old man isn't completely crucified yet. He's not dead. He's not completely dead. He rises up at times and thoughts that I ought not entertain, and you know how it is. I don't need to tell you, you know. Let's look at Ephesians, the 4th chapter, where Paul was talking about this old man again. Found out it's not completely dead because Paul's saying we need to get rid of it. We still got it, but we got to get rid of it. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 22, he's saying in the end of verse 21, this is the truth in Jesus, verse 22, that you put off concerning the former conversation, that means the former lifestyle, put off the old man, because the old man is corrupt according to deceitful lusts. And you need to be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. But I found out that's not an instantaneous event. I don't just get rid of the old man and now I'm in the new man's all I've got and I live in peace and joy and harmony and I treat everybody right and I never have a bad thought, I never say a bad word, I never cause anybody any trouble. No, it's not that way. I found out it's a process of putting off and putting on so that the old man is diminished and the new man is increased. But it takes a lifetime. That's what this life is about. If it was only an instantaneous salvation, then God would do us a great favor by killing us as soon as he saved us. If it was just an instantaneous salvation, then the moment you received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the best thing that could happen to you would be to die right then, ready to meet the Lord in the afterlife. But he gives you weeks and months and years and decades. I've had the baptism of the Holy Spirit since A long time. 47 years. And I found that there's still that old man in there. The new man is stronger than it one time was, but I'm still wrestling against this. How about you? I'm not the only one confessing here, am I? Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 9. Lie not one to another. Well, you know, you're a child of God. No child of God should ever lie. That's right. Why? Because you've put off the old man with his deeds. And you've put on the new man, which is renewed in the knowledge after the image of him that created him. There's a certain conduct that we don't engage in because we're putting this off. Now, we who've been redeemed, we still struggle. Sometimes we succumb to the temptations of the world, the flesh, and the devil. Other times we rise above them. Paul described this struggle very eloquently in the 7th chapter of Romans. And he was saying that it's a battle. It's a war that goes on. A struggle between two different natures. It's like there was an account in the Old Testament where there was two children that struggled against each other in the mother's womb. Well, there's two natures that struggle in the redeemed. The new nature and the old nature. The new man and the old man. And it's very difficult. And Paul waxed very eloquent about this in Romans 7, starting at about, you can start a lot of places, but I'll start in verse 14. And in fact, I'd like to read this to you, verses 14 through 24, out of a different version, out of the English Standard Version of the Bible. You read along with me in the King James, but maybe the English Standard Version is a little bit easier to comprehend, but I'll start at verse 14. It says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of the flesh, sold under sin." Verse 15, "For I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate." Verse 16, "Now if I do that which I do not want, I agree with the law that it's good." Verse 17, "So it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me." 18, "For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh, for I have a desire to do what's right, but not the ability to carry it out." 19, "For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it's no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. So I find it to be a law, that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being, but I see in my members another law, waging war against the law of my mind, and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death?" Now, Paul's describing the major conflict between that old man and that new nature. It's a major battle between the grace of God and the corruption of our fallen, sinful nature. Even though Paul was saved and forgiven and redeemed and filled with God's Spirit, called to the ministry, he was still not perfect, and he was struggling to crucify the flesh, crucify the old man. He said that in Galatians 5. He said, "Crucify the flesh with its affections and lusts." I'm going to read these verses again. I'm going to read them out of another version. This time maybe you don't need to follow along verse by verse, but you might just listen to this. I'm going to read these verses, and I'm going to go on a little bit into chapter 8, but I want to read it out of the Living Bible, which is a paraphrase in more modern English. And Paul said, just listen to what he said, "The law is good then, and the trouble is not there, but with me, because I'm sold into slavery with sin as my owner. I don't understand myself at all, For I really want to do what is right, but I don't. I do what I don't want to do, what I hate. I know perfectly well that what I'm doing is wrong, and my bad conscience proves that I agree with these laws that I'm breaking, but I can't help myself because I'm no longer doing it. It's sin inside of me that's stronger than I am, and it makes me do these evil things. I know that I am rotten through and through, so far as my old sinful nature is concerned. No matter which way I turn, I can't make myself do right. I want to, but I can't. When I want to do good, I don't. And when I try not to do wrong, I do it anyway. Now, if I'm doing what I don't want to, it's plain where the trouble is. Sin still has me in its evil grasp. He said, it seems to be a fact of life that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love to do God's will, so far as my new nature is concerned, but there's something else deep within me, in my lower nature, that is at war with my mind and wins the fight and makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. In my mind, I want to be God's willing servant, but instead, I find myself still enslaved to sin. So you see how it is. My new life tells me to do right, but the old nature that is still inside me loves to sin. Oh, what a terrible predicament I'm in. Who will free me from my slavery to this deadly lower nature? Thank God it has been done by Jesus Christ our Lord. He has set me free. So, there is now no condemnation awaiting those who belong to Christ Jesus, for the power of the life-giving Spirit, and this power is mine through Christ Jesus, it has freed me from the vicious circle of sin and death. We aren't saved from sin's grasp by knowing the commandments of God, because we can't and we don't keep them, but God has put into effect a different plan to save us. He sent his own Son in a human body like ours, except that ours are sinful, and destroyed sin's control over us by giving himself as a sacrifice for our sins. So now we can obey God's law if we follow after the Holy Spirit and no longer obey the old evil nature that's in us. That struggle goes on at times. In Romans 7 here, verse 21, Paul refers to the law that's in my members. I think he refers to it again in verse 23. That's that old fallen nature, that old man. It has to be crucified. It has to be mortified. In verse 22, he talks about the inward man, where the life of the Spirit of God is. And we have to lay aside. Isn't that what Paul said in Hebrews 12? To lay aside every sin, every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us, to lay aside these things. We don't have to continually fail in this struggle. As I was reading, Jesus, through his sacrifice, has enabled us to deal with this sinful nature that's in us. We don't have to be a slave to sin anymore. We can be a servant of Jesus Christ. We can strive against sin. We can strive to overcome. We can ask the Lord to forgive us. If we say we have no sin, John said we make him a liar, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, we looked at that. He's faithful and he's just. He'll forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If you back up a chapter to the sixth chapter of the book of Romans, verse, oh goodness, there's just so much about the what the power of God does when you're baptized into Christ. And it's not water baptism, but it's spirit baptism that we're dealing with here. And when that happens, Romans 6 and verse 6, we looked at earlier, our old man is crucified with him. And verse 8 says, if we'll be dead with Christ, we believe that we'll live with him. Knowing that Christ being raised from the dead, he dies no more, and death has no more dominion over him. Verse 11, says, likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So don't let sin reign in your mortal bodies. Don't be a servant to sin. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. If you're falling at the same stumbling block today that you were stumbling at 10 years ago or 20 years ago or 30 years ago, you haven't let the power of God do what it's supposed to do in your life. Because the Spirit of the Lord not only takes away the condemnation of sin, but it empowers you to be able to overcome sin. If you had trouble with jealousy 10 years ago, you ought to have dealt with that problem and gotten rid of it today. If you have quick temper and have problems with anger 10 years ago, so that it's so easy for you to get very upset, to get very angry, to get red in the face, you need to have overcome that through the power of the Word of God and the Spirit of God giving you the strength that you need to deal with sin, that sin is not the master anymore. You're not to be a slave to sin anymore. You've got a new master, and his name is Jesus. They called him Master. He was the one who could rebuke the winds and the waves. He was the one who spoke this world into existence. He has the power and the authority to give you the strength to rise above the weaknesses that are there. But you have to repent continually of the mistakes that you've made and acknowledge to the Lord that you want to rise above that. You may not be honest with anybody else, but you need to be honest with God. You need to be honest with Jesus and say, I know I have this problem, and Lord, I want to rise above it. I want to slay this beast that has kept me captive too long. The blood of Jesus can wash away the sin that's there. Yes, there's a sin that still easily besets us. Sometimes too easily besets us. But there's power in the blood. There is power. Power. Wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. And the precious blood of the Lamb. You can deal with the problem that we have. Would to God. If you don't recognize the problem, ask God to show it to you. Ask him to convict you of sin. Sometimes we harbor that bitterness or, you know, whatever it is, the animosity, the jealousy, the anger, the hidden sins. The hidden sins. And sometimes what sins we have that we think are hidden, everybody else already sees them anyway. What we think we've kept hidden, others can see many times. But maybe truly they are hidden. Maybe nobody knows but you. Doesn't matter how hidden they are, they're still sins. We've got to get rid of them, otherwise we're going to be in trouble. Backing up a couple more chapters in the second chapter of Romans. Started out in verse 4, very strong, powerful verse. Don't despise the riches of his goodness and his forbearance and long-suffering, knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. But if you don't do this, if you leave the hardness in a heart that hasn't repented, an impenitent heart, if you leave hardness there, the Spirit of God is supposed to take away your stony heart and give you a heart of flesh. He's supposed to take away the hardness. Oh my. Sometimes Christians have been justifiably looked down upon because they were self-righteous, because they had hard hearts. We don't want that malady to ever affect us. Sometimes there have been messages preached about repenting and overcoming and rising above weaknesses, but there are some sins that we have kept because they bring pleasure. The pleasures of sin for a season. I won't tell you that every sin is an awful, terrible thing. Some sins are pleasurable, at least in the short term. And we derive comfort from our own sins sometimes. When I'm criticizing my sister, it causes me to feel better about myself. It helps my self-esteem. Because, see, they're just as bad as I am. And they're maybe even worse than I am. So I derive certain pleasure from criticizing people. And I derive certain comfort from being angry at people. And if I hold on to those, they become very strong and hard. They become part of a stone in my heart, whereas I should have a heart that's tender and soft. There's times when people need my forgiveness, but I'm just speaking generically here for all of us. There's times that our heart's too hard to really extend the forgiveness that somebody else needs. We just won't do it. I can't forgive them. I just can't forgive them for what they've done. Why? Because your heart has been hardened. It's not tender. It's not soft. If your heart was tender, you'd be quick to forgive. Forgiveness really ought to come very easy to the forgiven. The Lord's forgiven you so much, it ought to be very easy to forgive others. And so, if we keep hardness in our heart, and if we don't repent, an impenitent heart, that means a heart that doesn't repent, won't repent, doesn't feel the need to repent. I didn't do anything wrong. It's all her. She's the one who did it. I didn't do anything wrong. I don't have anything to repent about. If you keep that impenitent heart, then you're going to treasure up wrath. See, we just, in the verse before, talked about riches of goodness. That's what I want in my bank account. I want a lot of God's goodness. I want a lot of God's forbearance. I want a lot of the qualities of God. But if you're not careful, everything that you find in your treasure chest is going to just be the wrath of God. The only thing you've got waiting for you is wrath. When you thought you were laying up treasure in heaven, all you did was treasure up wrath. Paul's not talking to vile sinners. He's not talking to the prostitutes and the pimps and the dope heads of his society. He's talking to the saints of God in the church. And he's saying, be careful. If you let hardness into your heart, if you refuse to repent, all you're going to do is treasure up to thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God, who's going to render to every man according to his deeds. I'd like to encourage everyone here to examine our heart and make sure it's tender and repent of every wrong we've done. Think about it some. What have you done in your life? How have you hurt somebody? Maybe it's time to tell that person, I'm sorry. I know it was a long time ago. You probably already forgave me and forgot about it, but I'm still sorry for what I've done. Jesus said, even in the midst of a religious activity, if you remember that your brother has aught against you, said, if you're in the middle of giving a big offering to the Lord, you know, part of the kitchen offering, and you remember that your brother has aught against you, says, you make it your business to go and reconcile with your brother and make it right. I believe a people that are dedicated to purifying their hearts and asking God to cleanse them of the sins that lurk there, secret sins that build their little nests in our soul. Things that you say, well, that's just my character. That's a part of my life. No. Ideas to change and not be the same old character you one time were. I truly believe the transformative power of the Word of God and the Spirit of God can make a whole new character in your life. You say, well, this is a family characteristic. Everybody in my family was a grumbler. Doesn't matter. The power of God can change just as it can take a sinner who's been a drunkard and in an instant at an altar take away the desire for alcohol. It can take somebody who's been addicted to drugs and in an instant it can change their very desires where they don't even want it anymore. I really believe that the power of God can banish and overwhelm and destroy sin in the lives of the people who ask Him with a pure, tender heart, a penitent heart, one of repentance. Paul had said to examine yourselves before partaking in communion. I believe that that's a good admonition for us, that we ought to be examining ourselves. He did not say to examine one another. What about him? What about, I wonder if he's repented. I repented to her, but she never said a thing to me. I don't think that's right. You're examining others then. Paul condemned that. Judge not that you, Jesus said, judge not that you be not judged. And Paul said, don't to be judged one another and partial among yourselves. But conduct a self-examination. Look inward. What's hidden in your heart? I'm almost through, but let me give you just a couple more verses. Let me go to Mark, the 7th chapter. Mark chapter 7. Because what's hidden away in your heart can defile you. Oh, I don't want to be defiled. Surely you don't either. Mark chapter 7 and verse 21. Jesus said, for from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye. I mean, when's the last time you heard a message against an evil eye? But some people look at others with an evil eye. Let's see, an evil eye. Blasphemy, pride, foolishness, all these evil things come from within and defile the man. If we have any of these lurking in us in any portion at all, well, I don't have very much bitterness. I don't have a lot of covetousness. If you've got any of it at all, it's defiling. And we need to cleanse that out of our hearts, to examine ourselves in 2 Corinthians 13. I'll probably stop with this verse, but in 2 Corinthians, the last chapter, the 13th chapter, Paul was writing to, again, to saints in the church, not to Skid Row sinners. But he said in chapter 13 and verse 5, he said, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Christ Jesus is in you, except you be reprobates? You don't want to be a reprobate. You can know for a certainty that you are in the faith. How do I know that? Verse 6 says, but I trust that ye shall know that we're not reprobates. You can know. And so our quest, our goal, what we seek in life is for the Lord to cleanse us, know our hearts today, See if there be some wicked thing in me. Cleanse me from every sin and set me free. That's what we were just singing. We have choruses we sing sometimes. Lord, purify my heart. Cleanse and wash the very inward part. Never let a single thing hinder me from yielding everything. Let my spirit humble be an example for the world to see. Let me dedicate my life an accepted sacrifice to have a heart that's pure, a spirit just like yours, and faith that will endure. That's my desire. To lift up holy hands, your will to understand, to move at your command. That's my desire. And we sing the old hymn, "Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Though your sins be scarlet, they'll be white as snow if you're washed in the blood of the Lamb." And so, not to walk in indignation or self-righteousness, but to walk in true humility before God, to walk humbly with the Lord thy God and ask him. In fact, I think before we receive our offering, we're going to bow our heads in prayer and just take a moment and say, "Lord, I realize that there's still things in my nature that I have not dealt with completely. And I want to ask you to forgive me for all that I've done, for the people I've hurt, for the things I've said, for the thoughts I've played around with." If we confess our faults, he's faithful and just. He's to forgive our sins if we confess our sins. He'll forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And not just ask him for forgiveness, let it be a true repentance, but also ask him to give us the grace that we need to strengthen the inner man in order to rise above the weaknesses that have assailed us too many times. Too many times we stumbled. Too many times we failed to show Christ in too many circumstances when we could have done better, when we should have done better. I believe the Lord would help us if we would pray sincerely. Would you mind? Let's all just bow our heads in prayer for a moment. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come sincerely before the throne of your grace. Each one of us, Lord, examining ourselves, looking inward, seeing that we have this old man, this old nature that dwells in us, that is corrupt and that is vile, that is sold under sin. And Lord, so many times we've wanted to do right, and yet we've stumbled and fallen, as Paul said in the 7th chapter of Romans, "When I would do good, evil is always present." Lord, we've struggled many times and failed too many times, Lord, when we could have done better. We didn't do as well as we should have. There were times we didn't show Jesus to a world that really needed to see you. Lord, there were times when we could have had the Spirit of Christ, and instead we had a wicked, devilish spirit. We failed so many times, Lord, but we ask you to forgive us of the problems and the weaknesses that we have. Ask you to forgive us, Lord. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, let the precious blood of Jesus still have its effect. Let it wash us. Make us as white as snow. Lord, give us that forgiveness, that clean heart that we need to purify our souls. And Lord, we need this power, wonder-working power through the blood of the Lamb, the power we need to rise above our sins and to crucify the old man with his affections and lusts and to mortify the deeds of the body, to take up our cross, Lord. We need strength from heaven. It's not in ourselves. We can't make ourselves do right. We can't make ourselves be good enough. But Lord, your power, your blood has reached to us. And there's strength and there's power. There's redemption, Lord, that we can have. You can cause the Word of God to be alive through your Spirit. I pray that you would help us, give us the grace, give us the strength, give us the power that we need. We ask this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, our Redeemer, our strength, our tower. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name, Lord. Praise your name. Amen. 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 Well, appreciate you listening, and I do ask you over the next couple of weeks until our communion service, a week from Friday night. We'll have that service Friday night. It's a special commemoration of the death of Jesus on the cross, but let's be examining ourselves and purifying our hearts. Right now, though, I guess we should receive our regular Sunday offering, our tithes and our offerings to give to the Lord. After this offering, I'm going to ask you to help me by asking you to give in our kitchen offering for our May convention that will be coming up the